I'll call the study session on custodial services to order at 5:41. Welcome, Dr. Shower.
Thank you. Tonight is another conversation about a piece of our budget. And as you know, we're going to be featuring something each time that we have a meeting. And so we have some slides to talk to you about tonight and opportunity for discussion. And the thing I thought I'd mention in the beginning is most of these topics have task forces attached to them and work groups, and this is no exception to that. What we're bringing you tonight is some preliminary information, really, that the task force is going to be discussing. And so I think toward the end, Jeremy will highlight that idea, too. So in case you were wondering, we do have a group of people that will be studying this topic. So I'll turn it over to Jeremy.
Thank you.
Thanks.
So the custodial services is one of the items on our budget balancing strategies. And so you'll see that we have it highlighted here. And we're going to continue to make updates to these strategies as we discuss them. So later on today, we'll also be talking about the capital outlay revenue limit transfer. And so we'll have that one, this one marked off, and move on to that one. But let's give a little bit of history about what we have in place currently for custodial services. So a little over 7 years ago, we first contracted out custodial services, and we had 85 in-house employees. And those 85 in-house employees were told that they would have an 18-month attrition plan, where basically over the next 18 months through attrition, we would phase out the in-house and become fully contracted. That got extended to a natural attrition plan where we were going to wait and through natural attrition, as the in-house employees phased out, we would continue to contract at a greater rate. As of today, we have 21 in-house employees remaining. So what we're going to talk about is that current model, and then we're going to talk about going fully contracted. This is an idea that has come up a couple of times over the past few years and is being reintroduced again. Then we're going to talk about a reduction in services, which is an item separate than going fully contracted. It's in addition to going fully contracted, how we can realize even greater savings. Then we're going to talk about some necessary reorganization. And again, this will be something that will be presented in our other groups, such as DLC, and it'll also have a subcommittee assigned to it to further refine some of the information that's being presented here today. So our current model is that we have 4 middle schools that are in-house. All other 21 schools and the district office are contracted through our service with ABM. We have building managers and lead custodians at each site. And we're going to talk a little more about that when we get into the reorganization. The fully contracted model would first retain that every site has a building manager or lead custodian. But what we'll do is those 4 middle schools would then be contracted with ABM, and the 21 positions would be eliminated that are currently filled by in-house employees. This would save us approximately $200,000. It also allows services to be performed during breaks, since in-house staff are off when we're off, whereas ABM will work on breaks, especially if there's work that needs to be taken place when kids are not in school. In addition to looking at fully contracted, we're looking at reducing some of the services on the contract so we can realize another $100,000 in savings. Now, the current plan that we have with ABM, which is very negotiable, is to take our resurfacing of gym floors down from 2 times a year to 1 time a year. Vacuuming would basically go from 5 days a week to 3 days a week. The trash would be placed in the hallways, so teachers would be asked to take the trash out of the classroom and place it in the hallway, which makes it more expedient for them to gather the trash at the end of the day. And teachers would take responsibility for their own whiteboards. And that saves an additional $100,000. The reorganization that we're trying to do is something we've been trying to accomplish through attrition as well. We decided long ago that a middle school needs a building manager and an elementary school needs a lead custodian. Building manager is held to a higher level of responsibility, and that's more in line with the tasks that need to be taking place at the middle schools. Now, currently, we have a couple of elementary schools who have a building manager, and we have a couple of middle schools that have a lead custodian. So we need to realign those positions so all of our building manager positions are at middle schools and our lead custodian positions are out at the elementary schools. That doesn't realize any additional savings, but what it will do is create greater consistency, and it'll make it easier from a management standpoint. So it's going to align the position responsibility with the scope of work. Other than that, we can open it up for questions on any of these given topics. And again, we'll have a committee that's going to refine that reduction in services to make sure it's something that everyone is comfortable with. And we'll also be working with HR to see what we can do to ease the transition for the 21 employees who are currently filling those positions. Some of the things we're looking at is the possibility for those that are retirement eligible, retiring and possibly coming back to work under ABM, or we're looking at some other transition services that we can provide for them. Questions?
On the resurfacing of the gym floors, is there any safety concern that, I mean, why do we do it as frequently as we do? I'm just curious.
I don't believe there would be any safety concerns, but the concern would be more about the lifespan of the flooring once we're resurfacing it less.
Have you received any feedback or discussed with teachers how they feel about getting trash out to the hallways and what cleaning whiteboards?
We have worked with KUEA President Aaron Kirchhoff and asked her to solicit some feedback on some of the initial recommendations, and this has also been modified to reflect the revised recommendations. And the feedback along the lines of placing the trash out in the hallway seemed that most teachers, not all teachers, but most teachers were okay with that. And the responsibility for their own whiteboard, again, most teachers seem to be okay with that. There was an item previously that referred to the trash only being picked up 3 days a week, and that was the item where we received a lot of negative feedback, and so we worked with ABM to let them know they can place it in the hallway, but we still need the trash picked up all 5 days, and ABM has been able to work with us on that issue.
Yes. I'm not a big fan of this, but I know in this fiscal age, we're really going to have no choice. But when I was in the classroom and we switched to contract, the classrooms were never clean. All right. Custodians that worked for us did a much better job and had much better rapport with the staff. And if we needed them not to vacuum one day or vacuum extra hard the next day, it was never a problem. Whiteboards were never taken care of. So, I mean, that's a status quo. And I'm not even sure if we supply the erase liquid because I bought my own.
And that's something we continue to work on. Jack, who works closely with facilities, I mean, with ABM, has developed a report card system where schools can report if they find deficiencies. And ABM, I can speak for their upper management, is very responsive, very open to different ideas, and very open to our feedback and criticisms. It's a matter of making that work ethic.
I wonder if it might help to have one of our principals talk a little bit about this, because we do have a system in place to address these issues, and I don't know if one of you would be willing to tell us how that works.
Volunteer?
We have a seat right here. You want to join us? Either way, as long as it works.
I'll say that I will echo what you just said as far as the quality of our custodians when they were in-house. And so there was a grieving period of time when we transitioned to the contracted company. We have been reporting. We had a report card, and we've been giving poor ratings. But I will say that the upper management has been very responsive, and there was changes in staffing most recently, and I'd say this last report card, I think we gave Bs. Okay. So we've been, they have been responsive, and they have been improving. So I would say we're hopeful now, okay, based on our most recent experience.
Well, and I heard you saying you're getting a visit from A+, and I remember going around this, that our lead custodian went around the school basically with our principal and a white glove, and a lot had to be done. So
we talked about this contracted custodial services way back when I was on Kate, I know 6 years ago or so. So I'm a little bit familiar, and I recall at that time being concerned about our long-term employees and not if they're just a few years from retirement, for example, and maybe even older. I think you said that is it ABM?
Yes.
ABM would hire them, but. Does that affect their retirement? Are they for sure going to be hired? I'd like you to speak a little bit to our loyalty to our longtime employees.
ABM has expressed that they would be willing to hire all 21 if that was the case, if all 21 are interested. The problem becomes that ABM pays at a lower rate than what we pay the employees, and they offer less benefits. Now, for an employee who's retirement eligible, it may not be as much of a problem because they can retire and collect their pension in addition to that salary, and because they would be collecting the pension in combination with the salary, then financially they would probably be okay. For those who aren't retirement eligible, it's going to be a little more difficult, and what the committee is tasked with is coming up with other mechanisms for how we can help them transition. There have even been ideas about what other positions the custodians may be qualified for that we could fill them into that are Kyrene positions.
So once the task force or committee works on that, can you come back to us with just a report about, because I wouldn't want to be left hanging with what's happening with employees.
Yes, once we finish the work, we can bring back the completed work at that time.
Thank you.
How long are we contracted with ABM, and if we've had problems, like Christy said, I mean, are we reviewing that and maybe like looking at a different vendor, or like how long is this contract for, and then what recourse do we have if they're not responsive? Are there other ones you're looking at?
We are on a one-year contract with an option to renew for 4 years, and that's standard for contracts. We've continued to renew with ABM, again, because of the faith in their upper management and how responsive their upper management is. We had these same growing pains when we first transitioned over to SSC. Once the 5 years is up and we've used up those four options to renew, then we'll go back out for an RFP, which is how we ended up with ABM in the first place, because at that point we then take the lowest bid.
When will that be?
I believe ABM is in the middle of their third year, so it'll be about two more years that they would hit the necessary RFP. But if we took the position that we were completely dissatisfied, then we could always, you know, terminate their contract at any point at the end of a year. But again, when you go out and you start with a new company again, you're always going to have those growing pains.
Like I said, I'm not in favor of it, but in these economic times, we don't have a choice.
Yeah. Jeremy, of the 21 that are still left, are they part of the original 85?
Yes.
So there's no new. So in other words, I mean, I think that Michelle's point is a good point, and I was actually on the board the first go-around when we first made this, made the initial move to contract. You know, these people are aware that this is, you know, for 6 or 7 years, that this was always a possibility, and, you know, it seems at some point, notwithstanding our compassion for our employees, that, you know, this has kind of been on the...
They basically had
six to seven years for natural attrition to take place. So in this fully contracted model, we, as relates to employees of the district, we would be down to 6 building managers and 19 lead custodians?
Yes.
So we would have 20. And what about in this building?
This building has, we have 7 building managers and 18 lead custodians. But as the building managers have begun to come down, it's made it easier to consider moving all six building managers to our middle schools. We have two middle schools that don't have a building manager. They have a lead custodian. This building has a lead custodian, but as far as whether or not this building should be considered for a building manager level of responsibility would be a different topic. The person who handles this building is very qualified, however.
Right. Well, I would certainly echo the thought that as many of the 21 or all of the 21, if they could be absorbed by ABM or whoever the contractor ultimately ends up to be. But let's go back to the first slide, the one with kind of the scorecard on it. You know, I think the thing we need to keep in mind, I think every week as we go through these items, is kind of where we are on the scorecard. You know, so, you know, at that bottom end, we're looking at $3.7 million. We know we want that to be closer to $5.2 million because of the salary increases that we would like to be able to implement. So, you know, as we look at the scorecard today, you know, we think that $1.9 million may end up sliding over to the low side. At least good possibility. We know the million is we think we're going to like that. You know, if you think we can get to 300,000, then you kind of start looking at, okay, we spoke last week, I think, a little bit about what the board thinks about the middle school number, so that one's a little bit shaky. So I just think it's important every week as we talk about these items progressively to kind of, you know, certainly what Ellen says is true. You know, we could look at every single one of these line items and say, I don't like it, I don't like it, I don't like it. You know, I think we all agree on that. But, you know, I think it's easy to beat these items to death every week and express our displeasure about them, and probably we should do that just so we're on record. But, you know, this one seems like a little bit of a no-brainer that, you know, this one's a little bit of the low-hanging fruit, not necessarily for the 21 people that may lose their jobs, but if we can get them employed by the contractor, you know, notwithstanding the fact that we have 45 minutes to go, this one doesn't seem like a bad idea.
Well, the point is, you know, that we're taking the time with you to discuss each one of these, you know, and one of the things we said in the whole budget process and our philosophy behind it is to make sure that you feel like you're shaping this, you know, so as we move forward, we end up in the spring with something that, you know, we feel pretty confident in as a team. So that's the goal.
And I think at the end of the board meetings, we should roll the trash out into the hallway. It's the least we could do to shape it.
But if they don't vacuum every day, it'll still be here tomorrow.
But you did say, which I think, you know, I do want to highlight that we will look at ways to absorb those employees. If there's a place for them somewhere within the district, then we will look for a place for them. I think that's important to let those employees know that if they are qualified to do something else, that we, HR, will be looking at that, because I don't just want to say that they're going to go to ABM and make a third of what they made here, but you know, that could be an option for them or something else. But at least if those employees know that we are looking.
Well, yes, we
will.
We will have personal conversations with all 21 employees that are impacted, and we'll do our best to aid them into a transition for what they'll be doing next year.
But the big problem is the whole economic structure of our country is to get rid of custodians that work for a company. It's a contract out all these things, and I'm not sure when we contract them out, it's a lower wage. It's also a lot less benefits. I'm not even sure if they get health benefits. But it's, you know, it's nothing that we truly are boxed into a corner, and it's nothing that we truly have a choice about.
I mean, let's not forget, you know, this is the same board that has riffed 30 and 40 and 50 teachers out
of. Yeah, but we knew they were coming back.
Well, I don't know what we knew, but, you know, this is, you know, and it's not just custodians in this world that are getting, it's not just custodians in this world that are getting outsourced or contracted out, you know, accountants and lawyers and architects, and, you know, that's just, it doesn't make it easier for the 21 people, but this is what people do.
Well, and, you know, I want to give HR some compliments here because, you know, over the past few years when we've had this hardship for employees, they've been really reaching out individually, you know, and we used to have an approach where people would get letters, you know, and it was somewhat impersonal, you know, so we've really changed that, and I know that they do meet individually with people and sometimes in groups as well to make sure that people know we care about them, you know, and we will. And each one of these 21 probably has a unique circumstance for us to help them with. And
right, and you so. Know, look, I mean, I think that, you know, when you're in these kind of outsourced models, I mean, I think Bernadette's point is a good one. Do they have health insurance? What are they going to be paid? You know, some of those things are kind of beyond our control, but, you know, we should look at these outsourced relationships like partnerships. You know, this is an opportunity for ABM to help us out and help out our 21 employees or as many as they can. It's not unreasonable for us to ask them to do that for us, and sometimes good deeds beget other good deeds. So I don't know if these are capable people. You know, I don't know why they wouldn't bring them on. They need somebody to clean those schools that are currently being cleaned by our people. So it's the same people. They're familiar with the facility, and if they're capable and they're willing to take the job, I don't know why they wouldn't offer it.
And I appreciate us studying to some extent each one of these things and you bringing each one forward, and whether it takes 30 minutes or an hour and a half, we'll try to do a better job in the future of identifying which might take more, so we don't necessarily have to have a study session start at 5:30 if we know that it may wrap up a little sooner. We'll try to, but this is all a new process, so we're learning along the way. But it sounds like we've wrapped up this one, and we may all get to have a little break until we reconvene at 7. Thanks. Thank you.
One chicken breast left.